What page number is 1 John start on? 185? 185. Okay, that's the new. Yeah, that's the new ones we have in there. So 185. Pull out a pew Bible if you don't have your own with you. I'd encourage you to bring your own so you can mark it, write in it. Special in this because there's kind of neat things you'd like to see. Like you'd like to there's the light is mentioned a number of different times and other words are there and you can circle the word and circle the second word and kind of draw a line between them and remember where things are. But I'd like to take you back just to the last phrase in verse nine of chapter one. Verse 10 before we go on. The last verse that we used last week, which was chapter 2, verse 2. We're going to start in chapter 3. Look at chapter 2, verse 2, the way it ends. It says, and he himself is the propitiation. Remember that means satisfaction, okay, for our sins, and not for ours only. And then what does it say? But also for those of the whole world. A lot of times there's this big, that's not big, but I mean there's one of the controversies that you find in a lot of churches. It's not controversy. It's one of the differences of opinion you find is limited atonement versus unlimited atonement. Has anybody heard those terms before? Okay, very few, some of us have. For you that haven't, this is a way you can step up your game a little bit and know a little bit more about what the Bible's teaching, because we really need to know the intricacies. Some people believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross only for the elect, or those who are going to be saved. And that's that's one category which they look at it. That's called, and they believe in limited atonement, which means the atonement was limited to those who are going to be saved, or primarily, as they would say, to the elect. My position and our position is called unlimited atonement, in that Jesus Christ's blood was sufficient for all, and sometimes we use these words, sufficient for all, but efficient for believers. So it's sufficient to supply everyone's salvation, but it is only effective on those who accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. So that's what we would call unlimited atonement. The atonement of Jesus Christ was for all and is broad in that. Another way of saying it is the extent of Christ's death is universal, but the intent is for believers. So Jesus Christ did what we do believe, that Jesus Christ's blood is efficient. It doesn't save everyone. Not everyone's going to heaven. Okay, so it's sufficient for everybody, but it's only effective for those who accept Jesus Christ, which is why we, when it says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father, what? Except by me, okay, then that means that it only comes through Jesus Christ. So those that trust in Jesus Christ, it's important for them. So anyway, that's one of the things that you'll find in the scriptures that is kind of a discussion, and that's other Protestant groups. And we're not talking about Catholics or Buddhists or Hindus or whatever, but amongst Protestants, that's one of the questions. Was Christ's blood, it was an unlimited atonement, or was it a limited atonement? And this verse that we finished out last week with is one of those verses that we hold on that convinces me that he died for all. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I know the first church I ever looked at becoming a pastor at, going to, and it's actually going to be associated with that church, one of the board members felt that should be really reflected in God so loved the elect that he gave his only begotten son. That's how really direct that person was, feeling that Jesus Christ's sacrifice was only for the elect, or only for the saved. It's not. He died for the whole world, and whosoever believes in him should be saved. And so we want to make sure the word gets out as much as possible to the others. And we're going to find out today one of the ways in which that word gets out. Through us. So let's take a look at chapter 2, verse 3, and we're going to go through verses 3 through 11. And I look at how this starts out. Now, if you have an NIV, you got gypped. Because the NIV does not have the word and in it, does it? In the beginning part of that? And yet the word and is in the text. And I think it's an important word. That's why I really like the New American Standard. That's why we kind of stay with that in the Bible, in our church. It is one of the versions that I believe is closest to the Greek. It doesn't mean the other ones are bad. It's just that they very intentionally, the New American Standard, want to try to get as close to the original as possible, Greek or Hebrew, so that we can understand what's going on. In the New American Standard, it says, and by this. If you look in the King James, or even the New Living Translation, which I think they're going to start using in the evening service on Saturdays, it says and. So and, or and by this, kind of connects it to the previous section. In other words, because of what Pastor Scott preached on last week in chapter 1, and the first verses of chapter 2. Based on that, we're moving on. So what happened in verse chapter 1 and in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2 are very important as we continue on with this particular section today. In the beginning part, remember it talked about you have sin. If you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive your sins. That's kind of the negative side of what our lives are like and how to handle that. Today, we're going to look at more of the positive side of how we need to act in our lives. So if you fail and you sin, last week takes care of that. But as we've taken care of that, as we look for how we're going on in the future and how we're moving on, now this part today becomes very important. So let's take a look as we start this. And we're going to start in verses 3 through 7. And I've entitled this, The Old Commandment. What is the old commandment? Obey God. The old commandment is obey God. As we look at verse 3, he explains it here. So I call this the commandment explained. In verse 3, it says this, and by this, by what we've told so far, we know that we have come to know him if we, what? Keep his commandments. Is it important that we keep his commandments? So many times we go through life, and what the Bible used to say, what says this in the Old Testament for some people, is everyone did that which was right in their own eyes. And that's what the world's doing. The world goes around living their life saying, I'm doing what's right in my eyes. I think I'm doing okay, you know? And yet, they're not doing okay. But they're, because they're doing what's right in their own eyes. For us as believers, it says here, by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. So the question I would ask, do you know God? You know God? Well, what's it mean to know God? Well, you know, I know Pastor Scott. I also know President Obama. But, you know, I know who he is, but I've never met him, okay? But I know Pastor Scott pretty well. We've been a lot of times together, okay? So knowing someone and knowing about someone is different. And the question is, do you know God? And you say, hey, well, sure I know God. Well, how do you answer that question? Well, here's how you answer it right here. If we keep his commandments. So do you know God? If you say yes, then you're saying I keep his commandments. I'm not saying you're perfect, but I'm saying that's the direction you go. For the common person out there, you say, do you know God? Oh, yeah, I know God. I'm pretty good, you know. I'm good. And, okay. And you look at the lifestyle and you say, that person's not good, you know. They don't know it, maybe, but they're not good. They think they know God, but they're not following his commandments. They may go to church on a Sunday morning. They may do some things that they think are checking the block. But what John's saying here is that knowing God is not just a thing, oh, I know God. Yeah, there's a God out there someplace. He's saying it's more personal. It's, are we obeying his commandments? Now, if you take a look in the scriptures, let's just go back briefly to John chapter 14, back to his very gospel itself. And if you can turn back here, I'm going to shout out a couple of verses. I'm going to read them very quickly, which means maybe more quickly than I normally talk. I don't know. John chapter 14. I just want to point out a few verses to you here. John chapter 14, and we're going to start in verse 15, and we're going to kind of hopscotch through this. I'm going to ask you, do you think keeping God's commandments are important for the believer? Okay, look at these verses. Chapter 14, verse 15. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Look over at verse 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will disclose myself to him. Go on, skip verse 22, and go down to verse 23 and 30, 24. Jesus answered and said, if anyone loves me, he will, what? Keep my word. And we will come to him and make our abode with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words. Are you getting the picture here? Turn over to chapter 15, one more chapter over, verse 10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Ephesians 2:10. We all know, well, I shouldn't say we all, but many of us know Ephesians 2:8-9, right? For by grace you have been saved through faith, and not out of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Do you know what verse 10 says? For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, what? For good works, We're created in order to do the good works that God wants us to do. That's the purpose of the Christian. Not just to get saved and end there. There's a process. When we talk about salvation, there's three words we use. Justification, glorification, and sanctification. Justification is just as if I'd always done right. Some of us say just as if I'd always sinned, but I say just as if we'd always done right because Christ's righteousness comes on us. That's what happens when you get saved. But then the sanctification, which is being set apart to do what God wants us to do, and that's every day of our lives. Sanctification is being set apart from the world and doing what God wants us to do or obeying His word. That's the part of our salvation also, sanctification. And then there's glorification. What's glorification? That's when we receive the new body and we're glorified and we become in heaven and we're part of heaven with God and we have the new body. That's the glory. That's the ultimate salvation when it's the realization of the other two parts of salvation. So right now we're living in that sanctification realm to live like God wants us to live. Let me look at one other verse with you, which I think is really important. If you have chance to look at it, Philippians chapter 2, you can. If not, I'll read it to you, Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. You can write it in your notes. It says this, "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Now, some people would pull that out of context and say, see, you work for your salvation. That's not what he's saying. He says, work out your salvation. What is sanctification? Sanctification is being set apart to do what God wants you to do. So you work out your own salvation by doing the works that are demanded by the fact that we're justified and we're part of God. And Paul here is complimenting the Philippians on the fact that they've been doing it. So we move on. The commandment explained in verse 3 moves on to verse 4 and 5, which is the possible responses. Now, what is the believer's response? There's two possibilities. And how many people have you heard say, I don't want to go to church because it's full of a bunch of... Oh, we all know that. Well, here's the hypocrite, and here's the disciple. We get to see the difference right here in this section. Look with me at verses 4 and 5. The possible responses are discussed here in verses 4 or 5, and option A is the hypocrite. The hypocrite. Here's where we go. Let me read verse 4 with us. "The one who says, I have come to know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him." So if you say that you know God and you're not keeping God's commandments, what are you? A liar. Yeah, we don't like to call ourselves that or say that, do we? But that's what it is. If you answer the question, yes, I know God, and you're not keeping the commandments that you know God says, then you're a liar and the truth is not in you. That's the hypocrite. That's the one that the world sees and says, oh, they say they know God, but look how they act. They do this, and they use this language, and they tell that story, and they cheat on the job, and they have all kinds of reasons to say, that person's just a hypocrite. The only thing that makes that it looks like they might be a Christian is they attend a Christian church on a Sunday morning, but as soon as they walk out the door, they leave their faith at the church. That is the hypocrite, and that's why. Because they are not obeying God's commandments. And if you say you know God and you don't obey God's commandments, you are a liar. Yes, and a hypocrite. So that's what we want to, so that's what's important for us to think about. What's the claim? I have a few things down here. The claim that they make is that they know God. What's their action? They don't obey God. What's the reality? They're a liar with no truth. There's a story of the guy that was riding down the road, and he was speeding, going a little too fast, and the cop pulled him over. And the cop walked up to his car and said, "Can I see your license and insurance, please?" He said, "Will you guys make up your mind?" The policeman said, "What do you mean, make up your mind?" He said, "Yesterday you took my license, and today you want to see it." We need to obey God, okay? Knowing God is obeying Him and doing what He says. Okay, following the law. Okay, the reality is that we need to be able to not be the liar. And if you look at chapter 1, verse 6, in 1 John here, chapter 1, verse 6 says, "If we say we have fellowship with Him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth." So this is a critical thing for us as Christians, because other people are watching us. It's critical. How are they looking at us? And if the person says, I'm not going to that church because it's full of a bunch of hypocrites, and you're one of those hypocrites that is not following God's word, then we have a problem. You have a problem with God. And so this is important for us. This is key for how we live our lives. There's the age-old question, you know, well, what about the person who gets saved and they don't evidence salvation? Do they lose their salvation? Well, I don't believe they lose their salvation, because I think if a person is saved, they keep it all the time. There's numerous scriptures in the Bible that convince us that once a person is saved, they're always saved. Jesus Christ paid for our sins, past, present, and future. Now, some people worry about that because they think that gives them a license to, in the James Bond series, license to kill, a license to sin. And so I can get saved, raise my hand, and then I can do anything I want, and I'll get to heaven anyway. Well, I'm glad I'm not going to be glad to have to judge that person, okay? But if you accept Jesus Christ, he takes away your sin and makes you eligible for heaven. And he doesn't take that back. However, what about the person that walks the aisle, a Billy Graham crusade, or raises her hand at a service, and then nothing ever happens in their life? They don't follow God. They keep the same lifestyle. They keep on sinning. They keep on doing the same kind of stuff they did, which is obviously very contrary to what the scriptures say. Well, my answer for that is this. I think that what he's saying here is, if we know God, if we follow his commandments, it doesn't cause us to lose our salvation, but it's kind of a validity of our salvation. Do we actually know God? And it's shown by how we act. And so for that person, I'd have to question, well, did they ever accept Jesus Christ in the first place? Did they ever know him as their true personal Savior? And I can't answer that. I was asked to do a funeral this last week, and I didn't wind up doing it because someone else, a family member, wound up being able to come through for it. But the question was being asked is that person died, and the person I was talking to in the family said, you know, they got saved, they've probably raised their hand more than anybody else in the world as far as getting saved, but there was never any evidence. And, you know, is this person in heaven? I said, well, I don't know. All we can do is hope that they really sincerely meant it when they accepted Jesus Christ. But there is no fruit. And consequently, that's the kind of person that might encourage others to not come to church, because they say, oh, that person says they're a churchgoer or whatever, but they know there's no fruit in their lives. They're just a liar. And that's what we can be called. So it's important that we follow this and we not wind up under option A, which is the hypocrite. What is option B? Well, that's in verse 5. So we read verse 5 and it says, and whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God has been truly perfected, or has truly been perfected. By this we know that we are in him. So the confidence that we know that we're one of Jesus' children, one of God's children, is the fact that we live a life that reflects that to others and reflects that to God. Now, again, that's why John started with sin in the first chapter. You know, if we confess our sins, we do sin. It's not a license to sin, and I'm not saying you should go out and just sin and just say, oh, I can't help myself, I'm going to sin. No, we can help ourselves. But when we get caught, when we accidentally sin, when we even intentionally sin, there is a confession process, and there's also a consequences process, you know? There's consequences to sin. Let's say we're unfaithful to our spouse. Well, you may say, I can do that, and I can ask for forgiveness. Sure you can, but you may lose your family in the process. So there's consequences. Separate those from forgiveness, from God. And yet we need to follow God. There is forgiveness. So that's why we start off with John 1, 1 John 1:9. But now we come to the place where we need to follow him and do what he says. And so for this particular person, I call this disciple, what's the claim? There's none. They don't have to make a claim. They're living God's way. Their life is their claim. What is their action? They obey God's word. They do what God says. The Bible says, the First Baptist distinctive, if you're talking about people who call themselves Baptist, or other people who call some people Baptist, that's how you got the Baptist name, is other people calling us that. But the First Baptist distinctive is, the Bible is the only rule for faith and practice. It's the only rule for what we believe and how we act. We don't go to the church fathers. We don't go to some book. You know, I mean, there's lots of good books that amplify what the Bible teaches, but this is the final authority, and actually the sole authority for how we act and how we believe. And so that's why the Bible is the only rule for faith and practice. So the option for the disciple is that the claim is that we have none, the action is we obey God's word, and the reality is that we experience God's perfect love and assurance of salvation. That's what he says there in the end of verse 5. Notice that? In him, the love of God has truly been perfected, been completed, been made full. If you want the love of God, that's how you do it, because we obey God's word. By this we know that we are in him. It is the evidence. It is the public and also internal evidence in our hearts that we know we're a child of God. Because we try to do what God wants, and when we don't do what God wants us to do, we feel badly. Now, all of us have parents at some point in our lives. Maybe you got adopted, so you had adopted parents. Or maybe your parents are gone with the Lord. Mine, both of mine are. But at some point, we were all children, okay? We had that authority figure. If you didn't obey your parents, were they happy with you? No, they were not. Did they still love you? As your children, sure they loved you. But they were not necessarily happy with you. And your relationship with your parent was a lot different when you were doing what you weren't supposed to be doing than when you were supposed to be doing things. And sometimes different children in a family may even have different bents. And one child tries to please the parents and do everything the parents want, and the other child just is that kind of that wayward kid and tries to push the limits. And, you know, it seems like the parents are playing favorites. They're not really, but one kid is definitely going his own way, you know? It's like Pastor Scott was preaching last night at Connect. You know, you got the son who is the prodigal son, and you got the one that's trying to please God, please his father. And the reaction may be different on both of them, and how he feels about them at the time, and yet he loves them both. And so it is that God loves us. And the reality is that as we learn the truth, that God works with us. And we can receive his favor. One of the old songs that my mom loved was Trust and Obey. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do a special thing here. I wasn't going to do this until I saw Reverend Mitchell came in this morning. Hey, how's it going, Herb? Good to see you this morning. I go to see him, and he asked me, his favorite question for me, Pastor Scott, is who's preaching this week? You or me? Now, I told him this week I was preaching, so maybe that's why he can't. I don't know. He had a ride because I was preaching. I don't know how many of you probably know this by heart. If you don't, trust and obey. Just sing the first verse with me, because the first verse talks about walking in the light and the way we're supposed to be liking. When Pastor Scott and I go over to see Herb, we'll try to sing. I sat down at the piano a little bit last week and sang with him. And he gets the tune, doesn't get all the words, but he oftentimes gets the words too. One week I went out on the porch and said, well, you know, Scott sits out here and plays his guitar for me. I said, well, I can't bring the piano out here, so we're going to have to do But just sing the first verse of this, if you know it, and if you don't, listen to the words. It's hymn number 571. Ready? When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And the first verse of that is where it is. When we walk with the Lord, when we trust him. Jamie, do you remember the story I often tell about you and that? Can I tell it again or not? Avoid it? I've told it 50 times, so it's okay. See, certain number of times you say something, it's okay, and then it's the public knowledge. But I remember the day that I heard a little girl, outside our house singing this song, Trust and Obey, because it was one of my mom's favorites. And I looked outside, and to my surprise, when I figured it out, it wasn't Jamie. Jamie's the one who would be singing it. It was the neighbor girl. And the neighbor girl learned it because Jamie must have sung it so much that she learned the words from Jamie and was able to sing it. But, you know, that's how much my mom and Phil go down to two generations and even to the neighbors affects this song, because it says that when we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on the way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, with all who will trust and obey. That's what we need to do. That's what salvation is like. It's not just having faith, but it's obeying what God wants us to do. So this is what the disciple does, and that's where this particular verse comes in. Verse 6, the right response is encouraged. Look at verse 6 with me. The one who says he abides in him ought himself to walk in the same manner as he walked. One of the verses that lends itself to this is Ephesians. And it's the only thing I'll say about this. I'll read the three verses if you want to write it down. It's Ephesians 4, 1 to 3. In fact, I think I put the reference in your notes there. It says this, I therefore, Paul writing, a prisoner of the Lord, entreat you to walk in a manner worthy of his calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing forbearance to one another in love, being diligent to preserve life, preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Ephesians chapter 4, 1 through 3. So even in that section, he's talking to the Ephesians, and again, he's telling them, walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you were called. And then verse 7, I call it the longevity exposed. How long has this been happening? How long has this commandment been around? What does he say in verse 7? Beloved, I am not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had, how long? From the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard. If you look through this, you'll find that in the Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 to 9, is one of the sections I believe he's talking about, where it says Moses, who we just talked about a while back in his series, is saying when your children are growing up, they have not heard the Ten Commandments, they've not been at Sinai, so when you sit down, when you rise up, when you're having a meal, teach them what God's law says. Teach them, so that as they grow up, they'll have it in their hearts and they'll know what it says. And this is a very, for any Jewish person, this is a very important section of Scripture, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 to 9, because it's the key to how they wind up training their children and raising their children. And I think it's probably the key to why young Jewish children very clearly identify themselves as being Jewish, you know? And they keep that because it's the teaching that they've been brought up in. And that's what we're supposed to do. It's the commandment which we've had from the beginning, teach them to obey. In fact, the Great Commission says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to all creatures, teaching them what? Teaching them all that I commanded you? No. Teaching them to obey all that I've commanded you. That's the purpose of the church. To preach, to baptize into the body of Christ, and then teach to obey. And when we don't obey, the world doesn't see it. Let's move on, because he has another commandment that he talks about here. Picks up in verses 8 through 11, just four verses here. Verse 8, on the other hand, I am writing a new commandment. So the old commandment is what? Obey God. Okay, good. Let's see what the new commandment is. I'm writing a new commandment to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. The one who says he is the light and yet hates his brother is in darkness until now. So the new commandment, love your brother. Love your brother. This almost parallels, if you look at the Old Testament and the Ten Commandments, the first few commandments relate to obeying God, and the other commandments relate to loving your one another or loving your brother. They're kind of divided into two sections. So this is when Jesus Christ was asked, what is the commandments? He said, first of all, love the God with all your heart, all your mind, so forth, and love your neighbor as yourself. Two commands, upward and outward. Two commands here, old commandment, obey God. New commandment, love your brother. Now, this is going to get a little hairy. We probably should skip this passage if you don't want to feel guilty this morning or be challenged this morning. You want to skip these next four verses because it really challenges us a lot of times where we see things happening in our own lives. The new commandment is introduced in verse 8, and I've already read it, so I'm not going to read it again, but in chapter 13 of John, if you look back there, he gives the new commandment. He talks about it more. So he introduces it in the Gospel of John, but now as he's writing this epistle in 1 John, he wants to repeat this because it's so important. In John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, it says, a new commandment I give to you that you, this is Jesus Christ, of course, speaking that John's quoting here, a new commandment I give to you that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Listen to this. By this will all men know that you are my disciples if you love one another. That's how the world knows. They look at us. They say, how's your love doing for your brother? And when they see churches that are fractured, splintered, I don't like this person, I don't want to sit next to that person, that person gave me, you know, offended me last week, so I'm not going to talk to him for the next 3 years. That's just what the world does all the time. I mean, if you want to go see some good fireworks, you know, go to, you know, go to a borough council meeting or a school board meeting in your local area, or go to the House of Representatives and look at the floor and look at them talk back and forth. You'll see how people get along, you know. And a lot of times, if you have people that are not together, they're like this, right? And how do they handle each other? You know, might be a fist fight, you know. But unfortunately, there are some churches that happens that also. In fact, when I first came here, I've been here a while, and I remember one guy said, you know, boy, church meetings aren't fun anymore. We don't get any more fights. You know, they didn't have fist fights here, you know, but I mean, he enjoyed the animosity, you know. But that's not the church. It shouldn't be the church, because we ought to love our brothers. That's what it's saying here. A new commandment is introduced. And notice there's no neutrality in these verses as you look through these verses here. Verse 8, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. So you have what? Light and darkness, the contrast. Then you look at the next verse, verse 9. The one who says he's in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. So there's love your brother and hate your brother. It's too extreme. So you'll see the contrast that come through as we look at this particular section here, going back and forth. There's also truth and lie. You know, if you're either in the truth or you're a liar. There's not a middle ground. We need to unabashedly speak the truth as believers. And sometimes we get in trouble with the world because it's not their standards. You know, there's a right and wrong when it comes to certain things, whether it's abortion, whether it's premarital sex, whether it's this LGBT, whether it's unfaithfulness to your spouse, whether it's lying, whether you're cheating. A lot of this stuff is okay with the world, isn't it? I mean, after all, God wants you to be happy, right? So if you're not happy in your current relationship, go find somebody else. If you're not happy following God's law, don't obey it. That's what the world wants. They want happiness. The Christian wants joy, and we want to obey God because we're in a different family than they are. We're in the family of God, and when you're the child of the King, you don't act like the child of someone who is in a much different place in their lives. You act a certain way, and we're the child of God, and so we want to act that way. So, again, we have the comparisons here. Verse 9 is the hypocrite. The hypocrite, and we just read verse 9, you can look at the text, you can find it. He says he's in the light. That's the hypocrite. I'm in the light. I'm good. But he hates his brother. And if the person that says he's in the light and hates his brother, where is he? He's in the darkness. So you can say, I know God, I'm in the light, but if you hate your brother, you're in the darkness. How are you treating other people? Do you have an offense? I mean, Matthew goes through the detailed offense. If your brother offends you, talk to him. If he still won't repent or you still can't make things work, take somebody else with you, one or two other people as witnesses to kind of try to help mend things out. And say, yeah, George, you really are this way, or Henrietta, or whatever the name happens to be. And then if that doesn't work, take it to the elders. But you need to work it out. Because people in the body, hating their brother, having problems with their brother, that person said that, that person offended me, that's malarkey in God's kingdom. That's not the way it should be. And if you hate your brother, you're in the darkness. You're not in the light. Black and white, there it is. It's not me saying, it's John. So if you want to shoot at somebody, John's in a grave someplace over there in Turkey, okay? He's the one that wrote it. And he's quoting Jesus Christ to us today. So that's the first option, is the hypocrite, and this the results is the reality is still in darkness, and it challenges relationships. We had an elders meeting this last week, and we talked, and you know, one of the subjects that came up, I brought it up, was relationships. While we have a great church, there are still challenges in relationships, aren't there? Relationship, I mean, there's challenges in marriages, and you know, there's many marriages breaking up outside the church, but there are within the church, there are marriage problems sometimes. There are people that can't get along with other people. There are children that can't get along with children. There are adults that can't get along with adults sometimes. And I'm thinking is, you know, we need a lot of prayer. Satan loves it when we can't get along because they need to divide us and it can pick us apart. If someone says something that offends you for some reason, talk to them. They probably don't even know it. Or it possibly wasn't intentional. It was said in a context where they thought it was okay. That's happened to me numerous times over my years. People see me in the front and they think, oh, there's the pastor. You know, he's very serious and, you know, this kind of thing and the way he goes, you know. And you go out, you're talking to somebody and you say something in a kidding fashion. They think you're actually mean it, you know, but you're not. You're just kidding them or whatever. But you can be taken wrongly. But you got to be able to talk to the other person. We shouldn't purposely be saying things that offend other people, because that is not what someone in the light does. That's what the hypocrite does. And that's why we wind up with these problems. What's option B? The disciple. Verse 10, let's read that. The one who loves his brother abides in love, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. So we have the same three things. The claim is there's none because it's not needed. What's the action? The action is that he loves his brother. There's an old lady who was getting up to 90, and she always got little gifts at Christmas, you know, and got to her 90th birthday, and they were going to give her birthday gifts. And the one son asked her, what would you love like for your birthday, Mom? And she said, a kiss right here. She said, I'm getting tired of dusting all the other stuff I get. having cleaned out a couple of our senior saints' houses in our own lives here, you know, you get all these knickknacks, and what do you do with them all, you know? Just a kiss. And sometimes that's what all we need is a brother. Just give us a kiss. Just give us a hug. Just give us a compliment to try to encourage a person and try to move them on. What is the reality? Abides in the light, and there's no stumbling. To live above with saints we love, that will be glory. To live below with saints we know, now that's quite another story. But that's where we live until we hit heaven. Verse 11 is option A, the hypocrite, contrasted with option B, which is the disciple. Let's read it. But the one who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in the darkness, and does not know where he was going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. So John ends this section by talking about the person who is really is walking in darkness. And it says he hates his brother. It's regardless of what he claims. Why he claims it is he hates his brother. He's got some sort of conflict. And what's the result? There's a number of results here. One is he walks in darkness. We're not in the light. The second thing is has no direction and can't find his way. Have you ever gotten up in the dead of night where it's black in your house and tried to walk around? I don't know who. Oh, should I dime me out, Pastor Ed? You know, he knows what I'm talking about. But and I know of other people. You walk in the darkness, and what are you going to do? Bump into something, and what are you going to do? Yeah, you're going to break a toe. How many? Should I ask for a second? How many have ever broken a toe? You know, you walked in and you hit something real hard. It's that chair, and it's usually that little toe. You know, right on the right side. They can't do anything for it because you're walking in darkness. That's what's happening to this guy. He has no direction and can't find his way. The Bible says, Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. But we're not trusting in the Lord with that. We're too busy getting upset about something that went wrong or what somebody said. We need to love our brother. And then it says, his eyes have been blinded due to the darkness. If you're, not just you're getting up in the middle of the night, it's dark. Imagine you're blind. I mean, if I take my glasses off, I'm practically blind. I can't see, you know? But, I mean, we're not talking about that. We're talking about total blind. You're blind. You can't see anything. You can't tell the difference between light and darkness. That's where you are. You're not just not able to see. You're blind if you don't love your brother. Now, I'm not saying we won't ever have disagreements. We always have disagreements. Differences of opinion. John Maxwell used to say, you know, if you surround yourself with people that have tell you the same thing you want to hear, one of you is not needed. So you want a variety of opinions. You want to make the best opinions. But it doesn't mean that you have to have it go to a problem with your relationship. So we disagree, you know? We disagree in the elders sometimes. We say, we come to the board, this is what it is. But we don't always agree with everything. We each other, we have different styles, different personalities. And yet God directs us with the Holy Spirit to move forward. And I think this last point, which it doesn't actually say here, but I think it really does imply, it says, he says he does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. I don't think he knows he's blind. And to be blind and not know it. See, he thinks, this is the way I walk. This is the right way. But he's blind and he doesn't know it. The people in the world are doing what is right in their own eyes, but they're blind. They really don't know what the truth is. It's in the scriptures. And so it comes to us to say, what is the truth? Now, I want to talk about something that every single person of you comes across probably most days. The word light in the Greek, somebody probably knows it here, I'll throw it out, is basically photos. Photos. Okay? And I could put the Greek up there in pressure, but I'm not going to do that. But I looked it up just to make sure, you know. So I have the Greek letters. It's right in my notes. If anybody wants to see what it looks like, you can come up and take a look at my notes of photos. Now, he also talks about writings. In fact, in verse 7, he says, talks about writing to you. Do you know what the word for writing is? Graphe. Basically, G-R-A-P-H with an A, a long A on the end. Graphe. Now, let me ask you, what happens when you put the word light and writing together? Photos and graphe. What do you get? Photograph. Photograph. That's what we are. We are in the light, and we're a writing from God. We are a photograph of who God is. Pastor Scott had a light. I had a lamp, so I brought my lamp because he took his back last week. And here's the light, you know? You need the light. If you have the light, that's important. Now, does anybody know what this one is? This is a relic. This is mine, my first camera. Anybody in? What's it say on the top there? Canon. You think of Canon, you think of copiers today, don't you? What a Canon. Anybody guess? Anybody old timers guess what the model this Canon is? Oh, come on. Canon AE-1. It was the prime. I mean, it was an expensive camera. Cost me a lot of money. I mean, I'm like $300 back then, you know, but it was an expensive camera, and it was one. I mean, I got one of the telephoto lens for it, and I mean, today I take a picture with it, and I can't even find a place to get it developed, you know. But this is the camera. Now, what does the camera's principle work on? How do you get a photograph? Light. How do you adjust whether you get the right kind of photograph? Two ways to adjust it. Huh? Aperture, right. Aperture opening. How big is that opening going to go? So the wider the aperture opening, the more light gets in quickly. What's the second way you can adjust the light on it? Speed, correct. How fast or how long the aperture is opening. So if you want to have a lot go into it, you can have it open a long time, or have a large opening, and open a long time. But if you have it open a long time, what happens? The picture's what? Blurred. Because if you have it open, say, a second, and a person's walking by, boo, there, you see it gone through it. So in order to try to get a clear focus, you've got to go down, and I used to do like 1,000th of a second, you know? But in order to get 1,000th of a second, what do you have to do? Open the aperture real big. So you get lots of light in that 1,000th of a second. If you wind up saying that you want to take a little bit darker, and it's getting dusk, and your aperture opening is as far as it will go, you can't get it open any further, what's the only other choice? Is to keep it open longer. So now you get more light in so you can actually see. But then you risk, that's when your tripod's coming. You've got to put a tripod so it stays still while the picture's being taken. Because a photograph, a photographe, is really light writing. Light writing. You are God's light writing in the light to the world. And the question is, when they see your light writing, your photograph of God, they see God in you. Are they getting a blurry picture? Is it underdeveloped? Is it out of focus? Because that's the only way they see us. We're walking in light. They're walking in darkness. God says, walk in the light. as I am the light. We are the writings of God. God has written on us what we're like for other people. This morning as we close, our theme is to walk in the light, obey God, and love your brother. That's how people see an accurate picture of who God is. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word today. We ask that as we continue to go through John, that you'll give us practical insights that we might apply in our own lives and that we might be able to be a photograph of who you are to the people who live in darkness, other believers who aren't following the light, or unbelievers who have no chance of really understanding the light apart from your Holy Spirit working with them. In Jesus' name, amen.